All right, let's get started. Welcome, everyone. Welcome to this CodeX speaker series event, the first one in 2017. My name is Roland Vogel. I'm executive director of CodeX, the Stanford Center for Legal Informatics. This event is co-sponsored with our Stanford Law School Center for Criminal Justice. So thank you very much to my colleagues at the Center for Criminal Justice for working with us on this event. Sorry, picking up some noise here. So it's a great honor to introduce our distinguished speaker today, Professor Jens Ludwig. He's the McCormick Foundation Professor of Social Service Administration Law and Public Policy in the School of Social Service Administration and Chicago Harris. And he's also director of the University of Chicago Crime Lab and co-director of the university's Urban Education Lab. In addition to his work at the University of Chicago, he's a senior fellow with the Brookings Institution, and he's also a research associate of the National Bureau of Economic Research and a co-director of the Bureau's Working Group on Economics of Crime. His research focuses on social policy, particularly in the areas of urban poverty, crime, and education. Professor Ludwig has written extensively about gun violence prevention, and through his work at the Crime Lab, he works closely with policymakers in Chicago and around the country to carry out large-scale public policy experiments to identify effective and also cost-effective ways to help prevent crime and violence. His research has been published in all the leading scientific journals, including Science, the New England Journal of Medicine, the Journal of American of the American Medical Association, and so on and so forth. He was awarded the Association for Public Policy Analysis and Management David Kershaw Prize for contributions to public policy by age 40, and he was also elected to the Institute of Medicine of the National Academies of Science. Prior to starting his professorship at the University of Chicago, he was a professor of public policy at Georgetown University, and he received his undergrad degree from Rutgers and his master's and PhD in economics from Duke. All right, so in his talk today, he will enlighten us about the important questions surrounding human decisions and machine predictions. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to Professor Ludwig.
Great.
So please
thank you very
join
much.
Me in welcoming Professor Ludwig.
Thanks so much, everyone, for coming. What a great crowd. It looks like a Donald Trump rally. Huge crowd. I'm from New Jersey, so I can get away with that. So what I want to present a paper that, so thanks so much for having me out. I'm presenting a paper that's sort of at the intersection of computer science and social science. And the team that we've assembled to do this, I'm an economist, and Sendal Malanithan is an economist, and John Kleinberg and Hima and Yure, who are here at Stanford, are computer scientists. And I'm hoping, I know the audience is a mix of people who know a lot about machine learning and a lot of people who know a lot about the law and social science. And I'm hoping that both strands of that bimodal distribution will walk away feeling like there's something interesting here. And so what the project has been about is to try and learn more about whether we can use machine learning to better understand and improve human decision making, with a focus on decisions that have very high stakes for public policy. And the specific decision that we are focusing on here is pretrial release decisions, or bail decisions. And so, as all the lawyers in the room will know, let me just give you a little bit of background on the setting. So as all the lawyers in the room will know, within 48 hours of arrest in the US, you go in front of a judge who decides where you await trial, whether you get to go home or whether you sit in jail. And by law, that decision is supposed to be, it's supposed to hinge on the judge's prediction of what the defendant's behavior would be if released, okay? And so this is a very nice, it's very high policy stakes, and it plays to the strengths of what machine learning is good at, which is prediction, okay? And it is a super high stakes decision if you're a computer scientist and you don't know anything about this setting. If the judge says, go sit in jail awaiting trial, you can expect to sit in jail on average 2 to 3 months, sometimes longer, maybe much, much longer, in places like the Bronx and New York City. And if you look across the United States at any point in time, we have about 700,000 people in local jails across the country, a population that is very, very disproportionately comprised of the most vulnerable people in American society, low-income people and minorities. The flip side of this is if the judge releases someone who goes on to commit a new crime, God forbid a violent crime in particular, that can be terrible in its own way as well. Okay, and so the sort of intellectual arbitrage opportunity that gives rise to the to this project and increasingly projects like this is if you go around the country and you look at what help we give to judges in making this high-stakes decision right now, in most jurisdictions, this is basically the decision aid that we give to judges, a stack of manila folders that has information on what the person was arrested for in front of the judge and what their prior record is. So this is like ye old decision aid. This is the same technology we would have used in the 1950s in courts, the 1850s, or the 1750s. And what's weird about this, what sort of the insanity of the whole thing, is that the same judge who spends all day reading through manila folders to predict defendant behavior to make a high stakes decision about whether you go to jail or not, goes home, wants to unwind at the end of the day, tries to decide, how am I going to spend the next 2 hours watching a movie, and turns on Netflix to help them with that critical decision about what movie they should watch, okay? And so, you know, this is something now that lots of people have had the insight that there are policy decisions that hinge on predictions. We have a very large and productive scientific literature about machine learning tools that take data and give us predictions that are as good as we can wring out of those data. Why don't we take the same tools that have been so productive in the commercial application and export them over to the policy application? And what our paper is about is, in many ways, not just the upsides of that, but thinking about what can go wrong. And what can go wrong are a bunch of social science problems. And so what I'm going to mostly focus on is thinking about what makes for a good or bad machine learning policy application, what can go right and what can go wrong. But since it's a mixed audience and not everybody will be so familiar with machine learning, I thought for starters it would be useful to just spend a couple minutes on what machine learning is from the perspective of someone like me. I'm a social scientist who is not trained as a computer scientist and sort of thinking about what is different about machine learning from the sort of econometric tools that social scientists are trained in. And so, you know, for starters, for someone like me, it was very useful to, for starters, to understand how computer science people have come to think about sort of a canonical machine learning problem like sentiment analysis. So if you're not familiar with this, this is a standard, this is a common problem in computer science. The goal is to take a sample of text and figure out whether the author was trying to convey positive or negative affect. And so here is an example of a bunch of reviews of a more or less randomly selected product from Amazon, the Hutzler 571 banana slicer. And here's an example of how this works in practice. So here's a review by Thrifty E. I bought this in order to speed up cutting up a banana for my cereal. Any time I saved in that endeavor was spent cleaning this implement. It's not easy to clean. You have to scrub between every rung to thoroughly clean it. And then the goal is to sort of get a computer to figure out whether that's a positive or negative review. And then you can benchmark that against ground truth here, which is the numerical score. So we look at that and see that it's 2 out of 5 stars. It's not a good review. Here's a review by Uncle Pookie. Once I figured out I had to peel the banana before using it, it works much better. Ordering one for my nephew who's in the Air Force in California, he's been using an old slinky to slice his bananas. You should really enjoy this product. 5 stars, great gift. Here's one by Q-Tip, confusing. There's no way to tell if this is a standard or metric banana slicer. Additional markings on it would help greatly. And finally, Jay Anderson, angle is wrong. I tried the banana slicer and found it unacceptable. As shown in the picture, the slice is curved from left to right. All of my bananas are bent the other way. And so this is actually an example. This review turned out to be hugely helpful to the Hutzler people. It helped them invent the next line in this product line, the 572 banana slicer. Now, it is so easy for us to read these reviews and tell whether they're positive or negative affect by the author, that you can see the early computer scientists working on this problem had a very straightforward insight, which is, for a task like this that's so easy for us to do, why don't we just introspect on how we do it and try and get the computer to do that, to do what we do. So introspect on what we do and program the computer to do that. And so here's some results from a computer science paper that tries to do this for movie reviews. And so the programmers introspect on what words they would expect in positive and negative reviews. Here they are. What words would you expect to show up in negative reviews? And we usually structure these problems where, by construction, half the sample will be positive reviews, half will be negative reviews, so 50% would be the accuracy rate of random guessing. And you can see that under this sort of approach, you know, you can get accuracy rates of like 60%, which is better than random guessing, but not that much better than random guessing. And this was the problem that the computer science community, as many people in the room will know, were having over and over again in lots of different applications. And then the breakthrough came from realizing that we should just forget that we know how to do this and treat the known like the unknown and turn it into a brute force empirical exercise. And the brute force empirical exercise then would be to take a sample of reviews where you have the labels, the one out of five star review, and let the data then uncover which words tend to show up more in positive versus negative reviews, and use that as your predictor for whether future reviews will be positive or negative. And when you do that with some wrinkles now, we can get up to accuracy rates on the order of 95%. So for someone like me, this is really sort of the magic behind machine learning, is to let the data discover the structure. The one quick addition that I would make just for the social scientists in the room is, let me just give you one more example of this. This is taken from Hal Varian's Journal of Economic Perspective paper on machine learning. And it is it's a graph of mortality rates on the Titanic with age on the y-axis and your steerage class on the x-axis. So third class, second class, first class, okay? And what you can see is, so all of us will have the intuition that, you know, we've heard the saying, women and children first, right? And so you would think that there would be a big age effect. And so what's interesting about this graph, and so the more darkly, so I think the X's here are people who perished on the Titanic, and then the more darkly shaded the region, the higher the mortality rate for people in that age steerage class combination. And what's interesting about this graph is that you can see for people in third class, there was no protective effect of being under the age of 18 because almost everybody perished at a very high rate. For people in first class, there was not much of a protective effect because almost everybody survived. And it was only for second class that being under the age of 18 had a protective effect on mortality, okay? Which is to say that there's a very strong age steerage class interaction in predicting your mortality rates. Okay, now, if you're an economist, I don't want to brag, but economists are very, very good at thinking that they know everything already. And so, you know, when you talk to an economist about machine learning, the modal economist, if injected with truth serum, or maybe not even injected with truth serum, would say, machine learning is just stupid, this is regression, I already know how to do regression. And then you say, well, look, there can be complicated structure in the data, and the economist will say, I am smart enough to know how to include interactions. So that's fine. But now imagine, like, just play this forward. Now imagine that you have a very high dimensional data set with lots and lots of candidate predictors. What is an economist going to do in this case? They're going to include every possible interaction of every possible variable that they have in their data set, right? The goal of these sort of prediction exercises is to get accurate out of sample predictions. Imagine you run a regression where you have a lot of predictors and you fit an insanely complicated regression model where everything is interacting with everything else. The danger is that you will wind up essentially fitting your data sample too well and start to fit to noise that's idiosyncratic to your sample rather than to real structure that is there. And so computer scientists will recognize that problem as overfit. And for me, the really interesting thing about machine learning is the idea that we can use the data then to start to tell us what the optimal level of model complexity is. And so this is a graph where prediction error is on the y-axis and some measure of model complexity. So this is tree depth is on the x-axis. And the blue line here is the in-sample prediction error. That is, within the data set that we're using to build the model, what is the prediction error? And you can see that, not surprisingly, fitting a more complicated model to the data that you're using to build the model will always fit that data better. The red line here is out-of-sample prediction accuracy. And the interesting thing here is that you can see that initially added complexity to the model improves out-of-sample prediction accuracy, but eventually you start to fit noise that's idiosyncratic to your training sample, and the more complex the model becomes, the less well you do out-of-sample. Now, the one final sort of twist to this that's unusual for a social scientist is, social scientists live in a world in which we're trying to identify, mostly focused on identifying causal relationships. So we're trying to estimate beta hats that link some x, the causal effect of some x, to some outcome y. And you can never know if you really have the right beta hat, right? Because how could you know? You need some structural knowledge about the way the world works to know if you've got the right beta hat or not. On the other hand, if your goal is prediction, you have ground truth. You know what the actual y is. And so that sort of insight one that lets you become more data-driven in choosing model complexity. And insight two is the idea that you can basically simulate what would happen out of sample, in sample, by using cross-validation. And so, the other sort of trick to these methods that's very different from what economists work on is using cross-validation to help you see the optimal level of model complexity from the perspective of getting good out-of-sample fit. So that's my sort of machine learning 101 overview for the social scientists in the crowd to highlight how this is so different from the sort of tools that we normally do. The one other thing that I would say about this that's interesting to me is I was at an NYU law school conference maybe 6 months ago, and I would say 2/3 of the questions from the audience were all of the flavor of, who are these people doing the programming? Have they ever been police? Have they ever lived in these neighborhoods? And the image that people have, the question that people have is like, who is this Dr. Strangelove character in the background doing this programming, making these decisions about who's going to go to jail and not go to jail, or where the police are going to patrol and not patrol? And maybe I've just dated myself by showing a Dr. Strangelove side. Everyone my age of 70 and older will get that reference. I think that way of thinking, now there are definitely a bunch of decisions that you have to make, but it is a very different type of decision, a very different type of decision than I think a lot of people sort of imagine for these techniques. Okay, so we are starting off doing a thing that will look a lot like normal machine learning, which is starting with the judge's problem, trying to build a prediction algorithm for defendant behavior, what defendants would do if they're released, using data from, so the judge is basically forming a prediction of their behavior, whether they'd commit a new crime or fail to appear in court, so that's a prediction of their Y outcome, so Y hat. We're doing this using, data, let me just skip over this, we're doing this using data from a large anonymous American city of 8.5 million people. And this one's a little subtle. You have to think about, or maybe be a connoisseur of crime shows to appreciate appreciate this one. And so let me just give you a little bit of flavor of the data. So we're going to do this using gradient boosted trees. What is important, there are two things that are, well, one important thing about the data that we're going to use is that the only demographic feature that we're going to give to the algorithm in generating its prediction of defendant behavior is age. That's it. We're not going to give it gender or race or ethnicity. And we are not all, we're also, the only other features that we give it are information about the offense that you were arrested for and your prior criminal record. And that's it. No information about where you live or anything else. And that's interesting partly because in this anonymous American city of 8.5 million people, pretrial services administers a questionnaire to arrestees that asks them all sorts of questions like, do you have an address in New York City? Do you own a cell phone? Did someone show up for you in court? Lots of things that you might think would be correlated with socioeconomic status or race or ethnicity or something else. So we're not going to use any of that information, just basically age, current offense, and prior record. And then we're going to take our data set and we're going to train the algorithm on about 500,000 cases, and we're going to pick optimal model complexity using fivefold cross-validation. So we're going to, you know, build a candidate algorithm with first four folds and then see how well it does in the fifth fold, and then cycle over all the folds. And we're going to report the results in a preliminary holdout set of 55,000 cases. And only once we finish the final paper are we going to show the results on our true holdout, which is about 200,000 cases that we haven't touched yet. So that's basically the structure of the data. And, you know, for starters, then there's a question of how you evaluate whether the algorithm, how good the algorithm is. And so if you think about sort of the usual machine learning way of thinking about evaluating an algorithm, it has some, you know, this is sort of a very standard kind of picture that you would see in machine learning, which is the ROC curve, which shows you the relationship between false positives and true positives. And, you know, the usual sort of game would be, I'm going to come up with an algorithm that has a better area under the curve than yours. And if you sort of think about this in the Bayes application, notice that there's something sort of subtle about the Bayes application, which is, suppose that I wanted to give you an AUC measure of algorithm accuracy in the Bayes application. I can only do that for the cases where I can actually observe ground truth. That is what you did if you get released, which means that for all of the people that the judge detained, I have nothing to say in calculating this sort of measure of prediction accuracy. Okay? And so then, you know, all the algorithm builders go out, they build their algorithms, they calculate their AUCs and blah, 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 and it's high and it's low and whatever it is. So I've got, you know, ours has an AUC of 0.711. Is that good? Is that bad? And so sort of the key thing for us as social scientists who care about solving a policy problem is we don't really care about prediction accuracy per se. We care about decision quality. So not prediction quality, but decision quality. What we want to do is improve the quality of the pretrial release decisions that are being made in cities like this, okay? And that is a release or not release decision. And you know, imagine that I had an AUC of, let's say I had an AUC of 0.95. So an AUC of 1 would be perfect prediction. Imagine that I had an AUC of 0.95. Would it be a good idea to take our algorithm and replace, let's take the extreme example. Should we take our algorithm and replace the judges with our algorithm? I don't know. What if the judges are doing even better than 0.95? Suppose that I had an algorithm that had an AUC of 0.55, which is barely better than random guessing of 0.5. If the judges were just random guessing, even a 0.55 algorithm in principle could improve on the judges. So, you know, most of the work in our paper basically came after we built the prediction algorithm, and it came from trying to struggle through this evaluation problem. How do we think about figuring out whether the algorithm is able to improve the quality of the pretrial release decision? Okay. And again, the challenge here comes from the fact that we don't have outcomes or labels in computer science jargon on the people that the judge jailed. Okay. And one key insight for solving this problem is going to come from the fact that it's one-sided, that if the algorithm wants to release someone that the judge jailed, we have a problem. We can't see what that, we can't estimate the counterfactual outcome in that case. But if the algorithm wants to jail someone that the judge released, we can evaluate that counterfactual, because we know that jail mechanically eliminates the risk of flight or public safety or rearrest, risk of rearrest. Okay. Or, and so here's, sorry, here's the other thing that makes this sort of different from a lot of other, you know, what makes this different from like a Netflix competition is that the data that, here's another way to say this, the data that we have are generated by the previous decisions of the judges, same judges that we're trying to compare our algorithm to. And the judges, in principle, may have lots of information that the algorithm doesn't have access to. The judge sees the defendant in court. The judge sees their demeanor. The judge sees whether the person had family and friends in the courtroom. Right? The judge has access to the pretrial release surveys that we're not making use of. Now, here's sort of the way that things can go completely sideways. Suppose that the judge, I'm not saying the judges should pay attention to this, but this is, suppose for the sake of example, the judges see whether teenagers in court have gang tattoos. And suppose that gang tattoo is really predictive of future recidivism risk and the algorithm doesn't have access to that, okay? Now, here's the problem. Suppose the judges use that unobservable to the algorithm variable perfectly. So they only detained in jail teenagers with gang tattoos, and they release all the teens without gang tattoos. And so the algorithm then gets trained on the data of teenagers that are released. The algorithm then says, these judges are idiots. These judges are locking up all these teenagers, and we can see in our data that all these teenagers are super low risk. Here's one easy way to improve on the judge decisions, which is, for starters, just let all these teenagers go. You can see in this stylized example how following the algorithm's recommendations in that case could make the world a worse place rather than a better place. And so this is, you know, if you're a social scientist, you will recognize this as a very standard sort of selection problem. An omitted variables concern. So here's, okay. And this is a problem, I think, that is not appreciated nearly enough as we are taking these machine learning tools into policy applications. And so let me start showing you some of the data for how the algorithm does and the judge does, and we can start to build up the case for how the algorithm is doing relative to the judge. So here's, for starters, what we can do is we can look to see to what degree do the algorithm and the judge decisions agree. And we can't observe the judge predictions of defendant risk, but we can get some sense for the implicit judge predictions that are implied by their release decisions. Okay, and so this is a graph that has the algorithm's predicted risk on the x-axis and the judge's release rate on the y-axis. And what you can see is that, you know, most people are being sorted into low risk or being predicted to be low risk according to the algorithm. And you can see that the algorithm and the judges agree for this part, largely agree for this part of the risk distribution, in the sense that the judges are releasing them at a fairly high rate. I mean, on the other hand, you can see that there are a lot of people who the algorithm says are low risk are being detained by the judges. But the real area of disagreement is we've got a sample of people here that the algorithm says are very high predicted risk that the judge is releasing at a rate of like 50%. Okay, so this is the range where there's the biggest disagreement between the algorithm and the judge. Okay. And so then you might say, well, you know, the algorithm's predictions are just predictions. How do we know, how do we know whether the algorithm is right or the judges are right? And so the next thing that we can do is we can plot. So this is just a calibration curve. We can show you, here's the algorithm's predicted risk, where we're binning up defendants into, I think this is 100 bins, against the average crime rate for each predicted risk bin. And you can see that the algorithm's predictions are pretty well calibrated. This is the 45-degree line. The people that the algorithm says are high risk are indeed offending at a very high rate, okay? And, you know, in fact, you can see, like, look at the riskiest 1% here. These are people with, so using just information that is available to the judge at the time they make the pretrial release decision, we can identify a population of people that have an expected crime rate of 58%. And the judges are looking at them and saying, out you go. Best of luck. Okay? You know, that's certainly suggestive of misprediction by the judges, but not determinative of misprediction, because in principle, the judges might just say, I've got a super high risk threshold for detaining someone. Maybe 58% is, I've got a 60% risk threshold. I'll jail everybody above 60% and let everybody below that go. And so the next thing that we want to try and do here in the data is differentiate misranking from simply the judges having a high threshold for detention. And so here's the sort of the second social science trick that we can make use of in trying to get some leverage over this problem, which is basically random assignment of cases to judges. So in the big city that we are working in, it is essentially the case that that defendants are randomly assigned to judges, or more accurately, conditional on, I think, borough, calendar year, day of week, and month. Conditional on those things, judges basically see caseloads that are on average similar. So this is to say, like, a judge working one Brooklyn Monday in February is seeing a similar set of cases to a different judge who's also working a different Monday in February in Brooklyn. Okay, so that's, and so then what you have is you have judges who are seeing similar caseloads, but we can see in the data that they have very different leniency rates. And this then basically lets us ask two sorts of questions. One sort of question is, where are the stricter judges drawing the marginal detainees from in the predicted risk distribution? And the second thing that we can do is we can say, is the algorithm able to do a better or worse job than the stricter judges in identifying the marginal detainees to detain? So put differently, the difference in leniency rates across judges basically lets the cross-judge difference in leniency starts to give us some information for the judges thinking about defendants in terms of their risk ranking. Okay. And so here's basically what this looks like in practice. So this is a graph that shows you who, so we take all the judges in this jurisdiction and we divide them up into leniency quintiles. So this is the most leniency quintile set of judges in the city, okay? And we've divided the sample up into predicted risk bins. And we're coloring in red here who the most lenient quintile of judges are jailing. And you can see that the lenient quintile of judges, they're jailing people, basically, they're disproportionately selecting people from the highest part of the risk distribution to jail. But you can see that they're selecting people from throughout the predicted risk distribution, okay? And so if the stricter judges were predicting, if they weren't misranking, if the stricter judges just had, you know, if the judges just had very high thresholds for detention, what you would expect to see is stricter judges basically prioritizing these people in the highest predicted risk bin for detention. So that would look like this. You were going to get down from the first leniency quintile to the second leniency quintile's release rate, you would just take the highest risk defendants and lock them up. And here's what you actually see. So this is what you would do if you were properly the judges would do if they were properly ranking by predicted risk. And this is what the second, the next strictest leniency quintile actually does, is they are detecting, they're selecting the marginal detainees from throughout the predicted risk distribution. Okay? This misranking turns out to have, so you can see the judge has lots of high-risk people that they could put in jail, and instead they're putting a bunch of low-risk people in jail instead. And this misprediction, and you see the same pattern across the leniency quintiles, this misprediction turns out to have very high consequences for society. So here's a way to see that. What we have here is the change in the release rate on the x-axis, and we have the percentage reduction in crime on the y-axis, all relative to the most lenient quintile judges. Most lenient quintile judges at this point right here, okay? Now, of course, locking up more people is going to mechanically reduce the crime rate, all right? So this dashed line right here shows you how much crime reduction would you get as you lock more people up through random selection, okay, not paying attention, just randomly locking people up. This point here is the second leniency quintile of judges. So they reduce the detention rate by this much, and then this is the crime drop that they get. And so you can see they're reducing the release rate by 6.7 percentage points, and they're getting about a 10% drop in crime. And if we were to use our algorithm to select the additional people for detention, you can see that we'd be able for a 6.7% reduction in the detention rate, we could get a 17% drop in crime instead of a 10% drop in crime. So this is basically free money on the table that we are not using by ignoring the ability to use the algorithm to make those marginal release decisions. The other way that you could imagine realizing the improved prediction accuracy by the algorithm is to say maybe we are happy, maybe with the big crime drop that we've had in the US over the last 25 years, maybe the thing that we're not so worried about anymore is crime, maybe the bigger thing that we're worried about is detention. So another way to say it is, suppose that I wanted to reduce the crime rate by 10%, how many extra people would I have to put in jail relative to the most lenient judge to get a 10% crime drop? And you can see that you could detain far fewer people in order to get the same 10% drop in crime if you follow the algorithm's recommendations instead of following the current judge decisions, okay? So we could either jail 52% fewer people or cut crime by 70%. So big, big gains to be had here. Let me, in the interest of time, because I want to make sure that we have, let me see. So in the interest of time, let me try and touch on two other big things, and then I'll stop and open it up for questions. So these sorts of exercises make us think that judges are really misranking defendants, and that we could do better if we were to, at the very least, use these algorithmic predictions as a decision aid for judges, okay? And so what I've shown you so far is just uses of the algorithm that go in the direction where we can evaluate locking up more people that the judge released. If you really wanted to use the algorithm in the real world, what you would want to do would be to build a release rule that would give the algorithm the option of deciding who to jail and who to release from the entire defendant pool. And so to evaluate that, we can't get away from the problem of having to come up with a counterfactual for what happens when the algorithm releases someone that the judge detains. And so we're going to wind up using imputation to evaluate in that case. And I can talk more about this during Q&A, but for a variety of reasons, we think in this particular case, imputation winds up not doing so badly, okay? And so here's what we can do in that case. We can do a policy simulation that looks as follows. So we've got on the x-axis the release rate. On the y-axis, we've got the, in this, this particular case, the crime rate, the measure is FTA, is our failure rate for defendants. And what we can do basically is generate a prediction of risk for every defendant in the pool, rank order everyone by predicted risk, and then construct a very simple release rule that says, let's just release people or prioritize for detention people in order of predicted risk. Okay, so if I'm going to jail just a very small number of people, I'll jail the highest risk people right here, and this is the crime rate that would result. And then we can sketch out, this curve shows the release rate, crime rate combination that you could get following the algorithmic release rule. Okay, and then the other thing that we can do, the other point on this curve that's of interest is where the judge is. And so this red point here shows you where the judge is. The judges are releasing 73.7% of cases. The judge gets a crime rate of 11.3%. The algorithm would let you, if you wanted to, keep the detention rate constant, if you use the algorithm's release rule instead, you could get 25% less crime. Alternatively, to get the same crime rate, you could jail instead of 20, whatever that is, 26% of people, you could jail just 15% of people. Okay. And another way to see this is you could basically reduce the prison, the jail population. This should be jail, not prison. You could reduce the jail population by fully 41% with no increase in crime at all. Okay. Now, let me skip over the concern about unobservables. I think that there are two concerns with this. One concern is, you know, the judges, the law says that the judges are supposed to care about one thing, which is like overall crime risk. In practice, the judges might have a different objective function. And so when we show you that the algorithm might dominate the judges, that could be sort of a misleading comparison, because it could be that the algorithm is chasing an outcome that is not the thing that the judges actually care about. Okay, so imagine, for instance, so I had lunch with a Cook County judge once on campus at the University of Chicago. I said, we were talking about the his decision-making when he was serving on bond court in Cook County. He said, the thing that kept me awake at night and all of my other judge friends is the risk that someone is going to show up on the front page of the Chicago Tribune that you released pretrial as having committed a horrible violent crime. So maybe it looks like we beat the judge on overall violent crime, but the judge is really beating us on, sorry, it looks like we're beating the judge on overall violent crime, but maybe we're losing to the judge on the outcome that the judge really cares about. And another example of this could be maybe we're beating the judge on crime rates and jail populations, but the thing that the judge really cares about is racial equity instead, reducing racial disparities within the criminal justice system. And so to test that, what we can do is we can build, so in the jurisdiction that we've been working in, the judges, state law says the judges are supposed to only focus on failure to appear. So we train our baseline algorithm on predicting failure to appear. And then we can evaluate the algorithm built on what law, the law says the judges are supposed to care about. We can compare that to the actual judge decisions on failure to appear as an outcome. And you can see that the drop there is 25%. That's the gain that I just showed you in the previous graph. You can say, well, maybe we're doing worse than the judges on the other things they might care about. Well, if the judge cares about any rearrest, our algorithm trained on failure to appear beats the judge on any rearrest. Maybe the judges care most about rearrest for violent crime. The algorithm trained on failure to appear also beats the judge on violent crime. Maybe the judges care about the most serious violent crime. You can see the algorithm trained on failure to appear beats the judges on that, that outcome as well. And the key to this working out this way is that failure to appear has a strong enough positive correlation with these other outcomes that an algorithm trained on FTA winds up dominating the judges on all these other outcomes as well. Okay, let me show you the result for race and ethnicity, and then I'll just show you one more thing, and then I'll stop. So I think as many people in this room are aware, maybe the biggest concern that has come out of the possibility of using algorithms for public policy applications, maybe especially in the criminal justice system, is the concern that this is going to exacerbate unfairness in the criminal justice system, particularly race disparities by race and ethnic lines in terms of who's detained. And so you can see why people are worried about this. People are understandably worried about this, just looking at how the criminal justice system itself is working right now in the US. So look, this is the first row of this table shows you who is in the defendant pool, the pool of arrestees in this large anonymous jurisdiction subject to pretrial release decisions. It is fully 82% minority in a city that is nowhere near 82% minority in the total population. If you look at who the judges in this jurisdiction are putting in jail, so this is the current judge decisions, the judges are creating a jail population that is fully 89% minority. So you start with a defendant pool in which minorities are way overrepresented, and then the judges with their released jail decisions just exacerbate that problem. So fully 9 out of 10 people sitting in a jail that rhymes with Schmeichers Island are minorities. And this is the crime rate that I showed you in the graph before that results from the current judge decisions. Okay, so as I told you, we built an algorithm that doesn't have access to race or ethnicity as a predictor. And our baseline algorithm just doesn't pay attention to race and ethnicity at all in any way. What do you get when you do that? Well, this is the crime rate that I showed you before. Relative to the judge decisions, you can reduce FTA rates by 25% at the same detention rate. And you can see that an algorithm that is built, a release rule that is built ignoring race and ethnicity, if anything, makes this problem a little bit worse. So you can see the algorithm reduces jails a slightly higher percentage of African Americans and a slightly lower percentage of Hispanics relative to the judges. And it's about a 1 percentage point higher share of people in jail who are minority for an algorithm that ignores this problem. But notice what the algorithm is basically doing. So the algorithm's release rule is basically just rank ordering all the defendants by their predicted risk, and then just going down the predicted risk list and jailing people in that way. Now, if society has a value that says we do not want a criminal justice system that is massively over-incarcerating minorities, you can build that value into the algorithm's release rule, right? You can build that value into the algorithm's release rule by changing how you count down the predicted risk list. You can start to pay attention to minority status as you are counting down a predicted risk distribution to decide who to jail. So one thing, for instance, that you could do is say, let's build an algorithmic release rule that says we are not going to do any worse than the judge, that we're not going to do any worse than the judge in terms of the share minority in jail. And when you do that, so matching judge on race, you can see that you can get a jail population that's identical to the judge and gets you almost exactly the same drop in crime. Now, maybe that's not so surprising because the algorithm's share minority in jail originally was pretty close to the judge. Here's something that's a little bit more surprising. Suppose that we say, let's build an algorithmic release rule that matches the defendant population. So the share of people in jail who are minority matches the share of people in the defendant pool who are minority. So now you can see we're reducing the share of the jail population that's minority from 89% down to 82%. So it's a 7 percentage point drop. And here's the interesting thing. There is very little drop in the gain that you get in terms of reduced crime. And if you go even a step further to say we're going to do no worse than base rate in the defendant pool or the judge, you can get it down. Let me see. Oh, we don't have that extra row. That's what it is. Okay. you can get it. Well, I guess this is you can get it down another percentage point or two still further with very little loss. And here's, I think, there are two reasons why this can happen, or I think two ways to think about this. One way to think about this is why I have this graph here. What is the alternative to the algorithm in this case? The alternative to the algorithm in this case are the same human beings with their same human frailties that are giving us a criminal justice system with 89% of the jail population who are minority. So this is the guy who wrote the Plessy versus Ferguson Supreme Court decision. It wasn't an algorithm that did that, it was a human being that did that. And so in some sense, the bar that the algorithm has to clear to be a force for justice is not a super high bar, given our current criminal justice system. And the other reason that we can move in that direction without much drop in the crime rate is because where the judges are currently releasing, at the current release rate, there are a lot of people with very, very similar predicted risks, right? And so it becomes possible to do some reshuffling to change the composition of the jail without compromising the crime rate very much. But that is a very convex relationship. So if this city wound up dramatically reducing its jail population, where we are now on the much steeper part of the risk jail rate combination, that dynamic would eventually start to change. Okay. So let me show you then one last thing, which is so the final thing that I wanted to show you is another neat thing that you can do with machine learning from a social science perspective is so what I've showed you so far is the possibility of using machine learning to generate really big gains in social welfare in this important policy application. The other thing that you can do is you can use machine learning as a tool for learning more about people's decision making. And so one way that we can do this is we take the machine learning algorithm and build a new prediction model that predicts not what the defendant is going to do, but what the judge is going to do. So we can basically predict the judge's release decision. And that algorithm never sees crime at all. The label that it's predicting, the outcome that it's predicting is the judge going to release you or not as a function of age, current offense, and prior record, okay? And so here's what we can do once we do that. So on the y-axis here, we have what we call J hat, our prediction of the judge's release decision. And we can bin those up by predicted risk quintiles, okay? And one thing that you can see in this case is, you know, it's not surprising. You can tell from these plots that the average risk. Here's the thing that I think is interesting from this plot is the much greater J hat dispersion that you see in the highest predicted crime risk quintile here. There is much more uncertainty on the part of the judges about whether they're going to release a case or not among the highest risk cases. So this sort of goes back to the first graph that I showed you. And here's, I think, another interesting thing that you can see, which is, you know, this is the same graph that I showed you before, where we take the most lenient quintile judges and we say, how much extra crime reduction can we get when we detain cases from released by the lenient quintile? So the dashed line, again, is random guessing. These squares here are the second lenient quintile judge, third, fourth, and fifth lenient judges. And this line right here is what you would get if you went into the lenient quintile judge released set and started to jail extra people using your prediction of the judge. Okay? So think about what this graph is showing you. What this graph is showing you is, here is what the actual judge decisions are. Here is the crime drop that you could get with your prediction of the judge's behavior. It's kind of amazing, right? So like, an economist would normally look at this situation and say, the judge has lots more information than the algorithm. The judge has lots more information than your prediction of the judge. The prediction of the judge is just an information-impaired version of the judge. Surely the judge is using all this extra information well. You'd expect the judge to crush the information-impaired version of the judge. And in fact, what you are seeing, is that the predicted version of the judge would let you have less crime or fewer people in jail compared to the actual judge decisions. Or here's, I think, the behavioral science lesson from this, is this sort of comparison of the predicted version of the judge to the actual judge decisions makes clear that the judge is getting led astray by information that seems to be very salient to the judge, but in practice appears to be irrelevant to the judge's actual, to the defendant's actual behavioral risk. So let me see. So here's, I think, what is what's exciting about this is that bail is just one example of an important policy decision that hinges on a prediction that a person is making right now, but in principle could be informed by machine learning. And so, you know, I think that the larger lessons here is that machine learning prediction tools can be useful, but we really need to worry about these potential pitfalls that come up that are very different from what you get in sort of a Netflix-style application that we're used to in computer science. And a lot of these are around the evaluation stage. And the progress here is not really going to come from improving our machine learning engineering. Right, this is not an exercise in getting the algorithm to eke out a little bit of extra predictive power. It is instead about having the right sort of framework for thinking about how you evaluate the algorithm once you take it into this sort of policy decision setup. So let me stop there. And I think the one thing that they were asking was, if you ask a question, you should come to a microphone. So thanks.
I actually have two questions. Probably because I'm just not intellectually capable to fully follow this. Can you maybe explain again a little bit more on what information the system is fed? So I understand it reads like existing court decision, but then when a new case would appear, what information would you have to feed the machine so that it can make its predictions? I don't know, photos, scans of the file, I don't know. And then building up on that and dismiss the second question if the first was already too stupid, but building up on that, if you say there's a method to calculate out race and origin, do you do that directly or is it indirectly in a system where somebody of a minority would already have a much longer record of priors than somebody of not of the minority, so that indirectly, even if you delete out the origin problem, it would still exist. So those.
Yeah. So if I understand the first question correctly, you know, there is a lot of information that the criminal justice system keeps that we are ignoring in building the algorithm. And so I mentioned the pretrial service interviews for starters that we're not using. It's also the case that the judge sees what the defendants look like. And so in principle, a clever machine learning person could use mugshots in predicting flight risk or whatever. We're not using anything other than age, current offense, and prior record. And in many jurisdictions in the city that we're working in, the court IT system is not totally set up to be able to generate real-time machine learning predictions, but they are close to being able to do that. And so I think that sort of IT upgrade would be part of what they would need to do in order to do this. But relative to the social gains, that IT investment seems like small potatoes when you think about 10,000 people sitting in the jail in the city at any point in time, and the possibility of reducing that by up to 40% with no increase in crime at all. I think on the here's what you might be asking with the second question, which is, one of the concerns that many people have about the use of algorithms in the policy area is that the data themselves might be biased. And so, for instance, one reason why you might be worried that that minorities in the US have longer prior records is that their neighborhoods, so a concern that people express is that minority neighborhoods are over-policed, and police set a much lower behavioral threshold for arresting someone. And what's interesting about that hypothesis is that, think about what the alternatives to machine learning would be in dealing with that. You know, right now the alternative in most of these jurisdictions is just the judge gets the case file, and the judge might have heard people say that there could be over-policing in minority neighborhoods, but the judge has, the judge is going to believe that or they're not going to believe that. The judge is going to do whatever they're going to do. The judge's head is the ultimate black box. If you're going to build a risk tool, the alternative would be something like a logistic regression, which is going to be, whatever the data analyst, however they decide to structure it. But notice what you could, in principle, do with machine learning, where you're letting the machine learner itself discover structure from the data. If you were worried about minority neighborhoods being over-policed and minorities being subject to a lot more bullshit arrests compared to whites, if you actually gave the machine learning algorithm access to race, and the algorithm is able to find all of this interactive structure, that would give the algorithm the opportunity to see, suppose that you had an outcome like failure to appear risk that is not potentially contaminated by that discrimination problem, the algorithm would be able to discover that each extra arrest for a minority means something very different for your FTA risk compared to each extra arrest for a white, which is to say that the algorithm would be able to discover that there is over-policing and a bunch of extra bullshit arrests to minorities. But that has a very kind of counter, if you talk to lawyers and you talk to my social science friends who work on discrimination problems, this is a very counterintuitive idea that the way to help the machine learning algorithm identify and fix discrimination in the data is to give the algorithm access to race.
Great presentation. So I wonder, when you show these kinds of results to that mythical 8 million population place judges who are known to be so humble, how does their humility receive this objectification of what they've been doing?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question. So, there are two sorts of responses that the judges have. One is, I don't want to lose my job. Being a judge is a cushy job, right? And the second sort of response is the judges are not dumb, and they realize that the risk tool, so in this particular city, the risk tool that they have right now is completely horrible. Like it barely predicts at all. And the judges realize that it is a crappy tool. And they ignore it regularly because it is has such low predictive signal. And I think the judges recognize that this is an important and difficult problem that they're facing. And I think, in that city and in my home city, we've been talking to a bunch of judges who are very eager for an improved decision aid to help them. And I think the key is to make clear that what we envision is a decision aid, not a decision maker. And I think the next frontier challenge here is going to be on the behavioral science side of how you think about building a tool that will maximize the chances that the judges override the algorithm only in the right circumstances. So every judge believes that they're seeing things in the courtroom and they're hearing arguments made in the courtroom that are special to this case that only they see and they can blah, blah, blah. But I've just shown you a bunch of results that say, on average, the judges are adding negative value by paying attention to that. And there's a great book by a New York Times reporter called Being Wrong, where there's a sentence in there that says, what does it feel like to be wrong? A lot like being right. And so the judges, they're always thinking, oh, I'm adding positive value. And so I think that we need to sort of develop systems where the judges are going to be able to learn as they go and figure out where they really do have value added and where the algorithm has value added. And for starters, a bare minimum basic first step there is to just build a system that gives judges more feedback. Because right now in most of these cities, the judges don't get any systematic information at all about what happens to the cases that they hear. Thanks. Yes?
Hi, thanks again for your talk. I was just hoping you could clarify something for me. So my understanding is you're using age, current offense, and prior record to predict whether or not you should release or not release the person. But the way in which you're training the data is you're using judge like past records, which you then say are problematic. So I was just hoping you could clarify the seeming inconsistency between using judge labeled data from before, which you then went to say was problematic.
Sorry. So the potential concern that you would have is that the prior records are contaminated by discrimination in the criminal justice system, that the police are going out. So this is a common concern that I hear when we go around talking about machine learning in the criminal justice system.
I don't actually think that's quite, I think it's more just I don't fully understand how exactly you're training your model. The outcome variable is release rate, whether or not you...
When we're predicting the judge's behavior, when we're predicting the judge's behavior, the outcome is whether the judge released you or not.
All right, but the outcome variable that you were using previously was whether or not...
Was actually whether the defendant is going to either reoffend or fail to appear in court.
Ah, okay. So then perhaps you could talk a little bit about this missing data problem, because I think because we are relying, like the only data that you have there is, as you say, for those criminals that... Could you perhaps talk about how you coped with the missing data problem?
Yeah, so the key, I think that the key insight is that the missing data problem is one-sided.
Yeah.
Or maybe the meta point, right? The meta point here is that if you're thinking about using an algorithm in a policy application, the thing that you need to focus on is whether the tool lets you make the policy decision better, not whether the tool just fits the data where you have outcomes better. That is like this is a very underappreciated issue in this whole area right now, and that would be, I would say, maybe the most important thing to take from the talk, okay? And then in this particular case, the way we make progress on that problem is by taking advantage of the fact that the missing data problem is one-sided, is that when the judge jails you and the algorithm wants to release you, we have a missing data problem in constructing that counterfactual. But if the judge releases you and the algorithm wants to jail you, we can evaluate what happens in that case. And so to see whether the algorithm is actually doing better than the judge, we, for starters, can focus on comparisons that basically horse race the judge versus the algorithm in making marginal detention decisions. And you can see in different comparisons, you can see that the algorithm is doing a better job than the judge is in making marginal detention decisions. And then we can do some policy simulations that say, now let's imagine a more ambitious policy which lets the algorithm go on both sides. And then there are some other issues to worry about imputing outcomes. But in this particular case, it seems like imputation's not so bad. Does that help?
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, thanks.
Hi, I just had a question about, it seems like you hinted a couple times at the fact that some of the data breakouts you're using weren't differentiating on type of crime that's being committed, like potentially when released on bail. So I was just wondering, you had the one part in talking about judges, what keeps them up at night is the idea of committing a violent crime. How big is that category generally? Because that's, I guess, one concern I have with the way we have our bail system set up. If we're just saying that it's potentially based off of any crime, that seems like it's a way bigger group than just this violent crime. And if that's all we really care about, then that might be something considering how the tool is predicting, if that makes sense, or if you think that's just like a policy decision.
I think all of this is a policy decision, not a social science decision, right? And so, like, the way that we're approaching this with, I would not want to live in a world in which people like me make decisions about what we should care about in making pretrial release or anything else. And so, like, I view our job as, you know, we have a bunch of democratic processes that lead to a policy decision-making system where the people get to decide what judges sit in place in making these decisions and what those judges should care about. I think that if you look at the data that we have, the overall rearrest rate is about maybe 25% in this city, and the violent crime arrest rate is maybe 5%. And the rearrest rate for murder, rape, or robbery is about 2%. And so, you know, you have diminishing prevalence, but greatly increasing severity per offense. And, you know, I think whether a 2% murder, rape, robbery risk is too high or too low is, you know, that's a normative decision that social science and computer science has nothing to say about. Does that make sense?
Thank you.
We have time for, I'm looking to see who's in charge. One more question? Okay.
In machine learning terms, you mentioned earlier that if you train on a data set that has too many factors, you tend to get worse predictions because you're training on noise. Am I understanding that correctly?
Yeah. No. Sorry. What I meant to say is, here's what an economist would do if you give me a data set with lots of candidate predictors, is I would either use my terrible social science theory to decide what variables go in the model, and social science theory is so bad right now, like that would just be basically equivalent to guessing. Or I would go in the other direction and do a kitchen sink regression where I throw literally everything in there, and that would lead me to overfit. And I think what the machine learning machinery allows you to do is let the algorithm go through the large class of candidate predictors and decide which set and how many turn out to maximize out-of-sample prediction accuracy.
And so, in a sense, you could say that the problem with the judge's decision is that they're suffering from overfitting in their own learning. So they're going through a learning process, but they're suffering from the same problem that machine learning systems could suffer from.
Yeah, that's right. They are picking up. They are treating. That's exactly right. The judges right now are treating noise as if it's signal.
Right, and so this suggests.
And a lot of that noise is stuff that is not captured in the data that our algorithm is using. It is not current offense. It is not prior record. It is right. Other stuff.
And so this suggests one approach that would maybe be a way of explaining to the judge population as to how they could improve their own decision making by pointing out that they're actually. Using noisy training data for themselves.
Now, but you know what's tricky here is that surely there are some cases where the judge's use of the unobservables to the algorithm really is adding positive value. So the fact that on average the judges are adding negative value, there's a distribution of judge value added, and the mean judge value added is negative, but that doesn't mean that there's not a set of cases where it's positive. And I think the trick here is to figure out how to develop a system where the judges are able to learn over time when they're adding positive value added and when they're negative. And this is why I said before, like, for starters, you will need the judges to actually get feedback on the outcomes of these cases for them to be able to do that. And most cities don't do that. Like, that seems like a first step towards getting this right, but there will need to be a lot of other steps beyond that as well.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Unfortunately, we have to wrap up here, but please join me in thanking you all. All right.